welcome to the show specially for model maniacs, people who can't resist the temptation to recreate the world in miniature. And on this series, we've been looking at all kinds of models. This time, we're getting all steamed up for model steamboats. And I'm joined by maritime modeler Michael Mayhew, who has two different basic types of engines. What are they, Mike?
Right, first of all, you've got the oscillating engine, and then you've got a reciprocating engine. Now, the oscillating engine works by the piston and the hole of the cylinder oscillating over a single point, allowing steam into each end of the cylinder in turn via two little pipes. It can be reversed any way you wish.
Okay, so that's quite small. That's
150 pounds,
right.
Okay, that's another oscillator, but that's in line. So the V and in line.
So then we come to the reciprocating engine. Now this is much more complicated, in as much as the steam enters both sides of the piston, allowing the piston to go up and down.
The piston stays and the cylinder stays fixed, and the valve, the slide valve in there, is operated by little eccentrics down there. And when I turn that, you'll notice that the eccentric moves and allows the steam to go one side of the piston down and then in at the bottom and pushes the piston back.
Okay.
And that comes out at round about £600.
So any particular one that you start with, the oscillating engine or the reciprocating engine?
If you were starting from scratch, a beginner, I'd go for the oscillator. It's a simple engine, very, very reliable, will self-start in any position, no problems at all.
Okay, so you're going to be showing us how to fit one of these in a model boat and get screwed up later.
Yeah.
And these are off the shelf, aren't they?
These are off the shelf.
Also coming up on this show, we'll be meeting a man who actually builds steam engines from scratch and the boats that go around them from any bits of scrap metal he can get his hands on. Martin Ransom reckons you don't need complicated tools to achieve stunning results. And the pressure's on, or rather up, down on the boating lake in Basingstoke, where model boat builders of all ages share their passion for steam. Now before we start getting into the details of steam power, Mike is going to show us the very simplest way how to power a model boat with a hacksaw and a piece of wood.
Yep, just an ordinary piece of plywood. We just finished up sawing
that one.
So we make a little V
notch
in the back. Now normally, in Victorian times, this would have had a piece of camphor in. But we're going to use a piece of household soap and put the soap in the V.
Did you do this as a kid?
Yes, this is all the rage. Just after the war, people, that's all we had to play with.
Okay, so you put them in there, and
the soap goes on there, and away she goes.
Wow, that is brilliant, look at that. So what is actually happening there, Mike?
It's the breakdown of surface tension of the water. The soap is actually making the surface of the water behind the boat wetter, breaking it down and propelling it along.
I mean, that's brilliant, that you can have two or three boats in the water,
yes,
or in the bath upstairs, you can have a bit of fun.
You can actually see the, after a while, the surface gets corroded over.
Right, you see the film, yeah.
The film starts to put in.
Not steam though, is it?
No, it's not steam, but it's fun, but a bit of fun it is.
Now, speaking of steam, we are now going to be going full power, full steam ahead to meet a man called Martin Ransom. He's from Bridlington in Yorkshire, and he has developed a very special talent. He turns raw scrap metal into the most elegant powered steamboat.
I just love messing about with boats. The funny thing is, I'm a lousy sailor. When we go on the ferries, anywhere, I usually head for a bunk, I'm afraid, but I love messing about with boats. Steam engines, diesel engines, the glow plugs, the pass boats, anything like that. I just love messing about with them. It's a challenge. I made my first steam engine when I was about 15. There were two of us at school, and we used to mess about with all sorts of things like this. We used to take them to school and get told off. Because we have a steam engine running across the floor, just a traction engine that we'd made. But it's just a bug that I've always had. I like boats, I like steam engines. I was looking for something different, and that one, instead of the bow going outwards and the stern going outwards, this one's, it's a bent banana shape, and the whole deck and everything looks like it's melted inward, and I thought, ugh. But it looks different. We'll build that one. But I didn't do it exactly to the plan. I chopped off bits and altered bits here and there. It looks pretty good. The bit in the bow is a working anchor winch, a homemade one. It lets the anchor down swiftly and pulls it up slowly, just like a real one. under radio control. Emily here, this is nearly a year's worth of work. 3-4 hours a day, and I have thoroughly enjoyed all of that. Every single thing, including the railings that you can see, the bollards, all these various pieces, everything, are all homemade from basic bits that anybody can buy from the nearest model shop. There's nothing fancy in this one at all. In fact, the chimney is 22mm copper plumbing pipe. Nothing special. The rest of it is just pieces of mahogany, pieces of brass, a lot of it has crowns from here, there and everywhere. Anybody who knows me brings me lumps of brass. They don't bring trousers, they bring a bucket full of brass and say, here you are, and I'm very happy with that because I can turn it into a steam engine. To me, I have built this boat for a kit and assembly. It's different. It's not something that I look at and think, I did that, because it just means I like to think I built those pieces. Two semicircular cups each side of the propeller, which can be swung as a pair to turn one way or as a pair to turn the other way. If those two cups are swung closed, the flow from the propeller, instead of going out the back, which pushes the boat forward, the flow from the propeller hits the inside of the cups and is deflected round back to the front end of the boat, so it goes backwards. So if you take the cups as a pair and swing them left or right, the boat can actually go backwards in a straight line, or it will actually spin on a sixpence. And it will spin on a sixpence. It's one of its party tricks. If you have an engine that will go forward and reverse, you only use straight flat blade rudder. But if you've only got a simple engine, which is how a lot of the steam engines were, it only goes easily in one direction. The rudder will reverse the direction of the boat from only a simple engine.
Martin's speciality is planking. He builds up the hulls of his boats with single strips of mahogany, bending them into place with his fingers and relying on his artistic eye to judge when the curves are just right. It's all done with skill and the simplest of equipment.
You don't need £5,000 worth of lathe. This thing here, I've been using it for decades, many decades, but it's a very, very basic lathe, and it's done everything I've ever wanted. You can get away with just a little bit of ingenuity, sit down, think about it, and work out the problems, rather than thinking, I need a 1-horsepower motor, I'm going to attack this lump of metal violently, and it'll be done in 10 minutes. For me, it might take an hour, but the end result will be the same. I don't need a milling machine. I like filing pieces of metal when I've cut them by hand. To me, that is a milling machine. I don't need anything fancy. That's a vertical milling machine. That's a horizontal milling machine. It's slower, and you need to be able to use the file afterwards. But that's the way I do it.
That's what I call very clever, making a steam engine out of scrap metal. Well, we haven't built our own engine on this, so we've bought a very simple one, but still, you need a lot of skill to fit it, don't you, Mike?
Yes, I believe so.
So where do we start?
Well, you've got to start with a hull, first of all. And this particular one is a styrene hull made from a piece of polystyrene and styrene sheet and vacuum formed down. But you can make it in wood, metal, fiberglass, whatever you wanted.
Any preference?
I like fiberglass myself. Well, before you can fit an engine into here, we've got to have something we can fit the engine to. So a couple of pieces of timber,
right,
bonded into the hull with epoxy, will make the engine bearers.
Oh, okay.
And they will go into the hull, and they're bonded in for the tray to be bolted down on.
Right, okay, so we've done that. We've got our hull. We've got our foundation.
And now, this is the engine. It comes in kit form, basically flat pack, as most things do today,
uh-huh.
And it consists of the boiler, the engine, and the bed plate. Now, the bed plate is all important because it's all been pre-drilled for you.
Oh, brilliant.
And following the instructions, you fit the various parts together.
Are the instructions easy to follow, mate?
I think so.
Right.
I think so. But then I'm biased. Once the boiler is assembled, you've got your safety valve, your fillers, and your water gauge that would normally fit in that place there. The positioning of that is very important in the hull.
Right.
For example, if it's an open hull, the position doesn't really matter. It's only regard to lining up the shaft, because there is nothing you're going to have for obstruction. But in this case, where you've got superstructure, the position of that boiler and that funnel is critical to the layout of the superstructure, because you do not want that to get touching anything here, because that can be in copper, can get very, very hot.
Okay, so we've got our hub, we've got our ends, we've got our breastplate there. What will do that?
Well, the most important thing is ventilation. Because it's a gas flame and being blasted into there and telling it needs air.
Mm-hmm.
And the more air we can give it, the better. In that case there, you've got no problems at all. It's all open.
It's open, yeah.
So the burner can pick up as much air as it wants. In here, it's a different kettle of fish. It's enclosed. So make the ventilators work. The hatch is open, the door's open, even the odd window out or open.
So they're not there for aesthetic reasons, are they?
No, it's there to let as much air, even these little doors here, letting air into the hull, because that burner needs oxygen.
Uh-huh.
And it also needs air to cool it. The other aspect, which is important in any model at all, is to leave enough space around the boiler.
Mm-hmm.
Do not cram anything around. Although the boiler itself is lagged with beautiful little strips of timber and looks beautiful when it's all finished, it still gets hot. And any flame escaping will set fire to your model.
Okay, well, speaking of firing, hopefully we'll be in a position very shortly to fire this up. Also, we'll be showing you what happens when you mix computer control with steam power. See you soon.
Welcome back to Model Mania, the show that is all about recreating the world in miniature. And as you can probably hear, the pressure is mounting on our model steamboat here. Now, speaking of pressure, Mike, when you're out there in the public, obviously you need some safety, there's regulations to follow. What's the structure?
Basically, any boat like this has got to have a boiler certificate.
Mm-hmm.
And any pressure vessel, i.e. the gas tank that's in there, has also got to be tested. So when purchasing new from the manufacturers, the certificate comes with it. But after 2 years, both the boiler and the gas tank have got to be retested. And they're tested hydraulically, because normally about twice the working pressure.
Right. And what pressure do you have here now?
Because at the present moment, you've got about 30 psi on there, so you've got plenty ready to go.
Okay, fire up then.
Away she goes.
Look at that. Beautiful.
Very smooth.
So, fuel wise now, obviously this is run by gas. What other options do you have?
The other option of the fuel are the solid fuels, such as coal, meter block, and possibly methylated, but I don't advocate any of those because they're uncontrollable. Meth is particularly dangerous.
Any particular reason why you would advocate gas?
Because it's controllable.
Right.
And through the radio control, you can actually get a kit which switches off the gas. So if anything goes wrong with the boat, you can shut down immediately.
Okay. Thanks, Mike. But in a short while, we'll be seeing a somewhat more sophisticated steam engine completely controlled by electronics. But first, let's see some of these in action as we go into the capable hands of the enthusiastic steamboaters of Bathe and Stoke.
This boat is a model of the Christian Brunning, which is a Dutch river boat. They used to use it for checking the waterways of Holland, make sure they're clear.
Right.
And in the winter, they used to use it for breaking ice.
Uh-huh.
And one of these days, we hope to go to Amsterdam to see the real one. The real boat is still there and operating to this day.
Oh, wow. And what I'm fascinated with is young Lindsay over there. So it's not just a sport, it's not just a hobby, it's for older people.
No. So young Lindsay's been doing it now for just over 4 years. Put a transit in her hand, she will sit there all day and sell these boats.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'm going to have a little chat with her now, see how much she enjoys the old sailing. Yeah. Cheers, John. Thank you.
So, Lindsay, what do your friends think that you're out on a Sunday afternoon sailing boats instead of listening to the pop bands in your bedroom?
They think it's weird, really. Yeah, because they don't really know boats as well as I do, they really think it's a little bit weird to be sailing out in a sunny afternoon when you could be doing other things.
So you think you're going to take this as a professor, do you?
Probably, yeah.
Would you like?
Yeah.
Charlie, Gordon Darren, great name for a boat. I'd like to know all about it, please.
Well, it's a double-action steam engine. It's got his name. Before it was finished, he's had an extra position, and the captain, Gordon Bennett, that's going to be nice.
Anyway,
that's what I called it.
Gordon Bennett, that's
going to
be nice.
Yeah, great name for a boat. So how long did it take this to make, Gordon?
About 3 years, I think.
3 years, a couple of hours here, a couple of hours there.
Yeah. It's all made out of odds and ends, sort of scrap bolster for the hull.
Like, what kind of things are made from odds and ends, for example?
Well, I think the only thing that's bought on it is actually paddle wheels themselves.
Really?
It's a bit difficult, isn't it? The funnel's made out of a piece of rainwater pipe.
Uh-huh. So what makes you go for a paddle boat rather than just a normal steamboat?
Well, it's nice to see the paddles going around, isn't it? It makes you think this weight.
Yeah, and out of all the steamboats that I've seen today as well, it's totally different.
We started in October.
And finished in May, Joe.
You said it.
Now, lad. So, how can you both build them more or less at the same time, as if they're a competition or anything?
Personal challenge, really. We both wanted to pick a boat that would be easy to take to different events, and we both decided on this one.
So, John, what's it feeling like when it goes in the water?
Well, it's actually built it and created it, and it's sailed right. You know, it just makes it feel good to get a bit of a glow on. Sometimes it's not quite the planning.
What kind of problems did you have, like?
Well, we run out of water halfway around, or the gas, and it just stops and waits, and it should overheat and basically melt down in the boat.
Yeah. And then that's when Joe has a little dip, isn't it?
Yeah, it's normally vice versa, though, Dave, isn't it?
So what about you, Dave? What do you like most? Is it the building? Is it just spin it in the water? Or
what, apart from John going wrong?
Yeah, apart from John going wrong, yeah.
No, you do get a lot of satisfaction when they're on the water, knowing that you've made the whole thing from scratch, and it's doing what it should do when it should do it.
So why do you love the steamboats in Oxford?
I'm an old-fashioned person, and these were the sort of old boats when I was a young man that I used to dream of in the old days.
Yeah. It's nice, though, isn't it, that you bring it back to life now?
Oh, yes.
Why steam?
Well, I've got sailing boats. I belong to a sailing club, and I've got motorised boats, fast boats and slow boats, but this is sort of an old passion sort of area. I mean, you've got
a bit of romance in there.
Yes. And it's peaceful.
Yeah.
They're very easy to make, too.
Well, probably very easy for you, but somebody like me, it probably took me about 4 years to make that. So you get the bulk of it in one piece?
Well, only the hull, and you get the engine and the boiler, obviously, but then you make everything else up.
That sounds crazy, John.
Better
than watching the telly.
Can you believe that, mate?
Yeah, I don't. I think it's hilarious.
Better than watching the telly. Anyway,
Some of those ships that you saw there were fairly straightforward, powered by the engine that we saw at the top of the show, which is the twin V oscillator, or the V-twin oscillator. But you can get more sophisticated if you want to, like this one here, which is totally controlled by electronics. How does this one work, Mike?
Well, this is the same system, really, except that you've got a reciprocating engine instead of the oscillating engine.
Right.
You've got a slightly bigger boiler. And let's get it running.
Wow.
And all this is operated by this little box of chips here.
Right.
And in there, there's all sorts of little electronics, little chips. And feeding it are two sensors. A heat sensor here, which goes down, and that picks up the temperature of the steam, or pressure of the steam, and tells the gas valve to open or close.
So if it gets too much or if it's too harsh, then that might...
It'll shut down.
I see.
And in the same level, there's an optical sensor on the water gauge, which, as the water goes up or down, breaks the beam and alters the electronic lubricant of the beam, which in turn goes to this bypass pump.
Mm-hmm.
Now there's a pump here, a little pump on the end here, and that's pumping all the time. It's sucking in water, taking it in, and throwing it back into the top of the tank.
Right.
Now, when this valve shuts, this valve then sends the water round this system and through and into the flat there. So it's a little pipe, either it goes straight down and back to the tank, or straight along here and into this flat and feeds the boiler.
Okay.
So it just sits and runs for days on end.
And it's running smoothly as well.
Yeah.
And how important is it to lubricate the engine?
Very, very. It's in a normal boat outing with a boat, I would certainly do at least two or three lubrications. I like to see oil.
Yeah.
And don't forget it's total loss lubrication.
Right.
So it gets a bit messy after a while.
And it's a nice example because you can see it all moving, can't you?
It's a beautiful
but electronically steamed engines, what a class of technology, Mike.
It's the old and the new.
A bit like you and me, isn't
yeah,
it?
Just like you and I.
Obviously I'm the old and you're the young.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Mike, thank you very much for your invaluable advice today.
You're most welcome.
Really. Thank you very much. And of course, thank you for watching. Join us next time. Who knows? It could be planes, it could be trains, it could be rockets, whatever it is. Join us next time.
Take a deep breath because we're going to go from models on the water to models underneath it next. Submarines feature in the following half hour hit of Model Mania.